ongoing support and your history of righting the wrongs of racial injustice in this nation. Thank you very much, Ms. Nadler, for your assistance and support of this legislation, beginning with our beloved late colleague, John Conyers, and to my colleagues on the committee, on the Constitution Subcommittee. I am appreciative of your graciousness as well in joining us in this hearing. Thank you very much to our ranking member, both Mr. Johnson and the gentleman from Colorado, I believe. Thank him very much for his statement today. And this is what this hearing is about, to be able to speak to the nation and for the nation to continue its overwhelming support that it has given to H.R. 40. And that has been one of the comforting aspects of continuing to carry this legislation. I'm proud to speak in support of H.R. 40 and the legislation that I introduced that establishes a commission to study and develop reparation proposals for African Americans. It is an active commission. It is to study, but it is also to develop reparation proposals. Now, we come from a community, a race of people that have been known as overcomers. We shall overcome, and we have overcome. Mr. Owens has eloquently spoken of the overcomers. We're successful. We believe in determination, and we believe in overcoming the many bad balls that we have been thrown. We've caught them, and we've kept on going. That is not the point of H.R. 40, the commission to study and develop reparation proposals for African Americans. For hidden in the corners of this nation are those of African American heritage, the descendants of enslaved Africans who have felt the sting of disparities. They continue to feel that sting. Now more than ever, the facts and circumstances facing our nation demonstrate the importance of H.R. 40 and the necessity of placing our nation on the path to reparative justice. That is what H.R. 40 is about. This commission will probe into the facts of the longstanding impact of disparities that slavery brought about in this country. We still experience them today. When this committee last met to discuss this legislation, we required three overflow rooms to contain the scholarship and the passion displayed in support of this bill. I'm very pleased to say that we have had over 170 co-sponsors, close to that now, and those members of Congress, I want to thank them personally because there are wide perspective and spectrum of political views, from progressives to moderates to conservatives, coming from all regions of the United States, all racial backgrounds. That is America. That is what repair is all about, reparative justice. Since that time, we have seen a pandemic sweep the country, taking more than 500,000 souls in its wake and devastating the African-American community. According to the latest estimates from the U.S. Centers for Disease Control, Black people get COVID-19 at a rate nearly 1.5 times higher than that of white people. They're hospitalized at a rate nearly 4 times higher than them and are 3 times as likely to die from the disease. We've seen it in our cities and our rural communities across America. Interestingly enough, a recent peer-reviewed study from Harvard Medical School suggests that reparations for African Americans could have cut COVID-19 transmission and infection rates both among Blacks and the population at large. Their analysis, based on Louisiana data, determined that if reparation proposals had been implemented before the COVID-19 pandemic, narrowing the wealth gap, COVID-19 transmission rates in the state's overall population could have been reduced by anywhere from 31 to 68%. Mr. Chairman, I ask unanimous consent to submit into the record the Harvard article.
Without objection, it shall be.
Since our last hearing, we have also seen hundreds of thousands. Since our last hearing, we have also seen hundreds of thousands peacefully take to the streets in support of Black lives and accountability for law enforcement. Many of these protesters carried signs in support of H.R. 40 and made the important link between policing reform and the movement for reparative justice. Tragically, we have also witnessed insurrectionists attack this institution, brandishing symbols of division and intolerance that echo back to the darkest periods of our nation's history. Clearly, we require reckoning to restore national balance and unity. The government sanctioned slavery, and that is what we need, a reckoning, a healing, reparative justice, we need to bring our nation together. And this commission is really, it is no figment of your imagination. It is a commission that will be appointed by the majority leader of the United States Senate, the Speaker of the House, the President of the United States, a commission that will be funded for fact-based hearings, the opportunity for all people to be heard, and then, yes, a reparative healing of proposals to deal with the questions of the starkness of the life of African-Americans in this country. Like our last hearing, the minority has selected two African-American witnesses to speak against H.R. 40. That is their privilege. But we know that justice, facts, and that life that was led and continues to be led by African-Americans is on our side. Their selection, however, fails to undermine the overwhelming support for this legislation and merely demonstrates the multiplicity of views within the Black community. I'd ask unanimous consent to submit into the record a message from the CARICOM Reparations Commission on the occasion of the United States congressional hearings on H.R. 40, Bill 17, February 17, 2021. Mr. Chairman, I ask for that submission.
Without the dissent, it's so granted.